Dobro veče svima, moje ime je Milena Berić I dobrodošli na poslednje veče ovogodišnjeg 12. festivala Krokodil. Završnicu festivala predstavlja, kao što I znate, Beogradske debate o Evropi pod nazivom Mogućnost Evrope 2.0. Večeras okupljamo neke od najeminentnijih evropskih I regionalnih intelektualaca I stručnjaka iz različitih oblasti. U okviru tri debatna kruga bavit ćemo se nekim od najvažnijih pitanja sa kojima se Evropa I evropljani danas suočavaju. Glavna tema četvrte Beogradske debate u Evropi biće pandemija COVID-19 kao I njene globalne te posebno evropske implikacije. Good evening. My name is Milena Berić, and warm welcome to the last evening of this year's festival, Krokodil. Festival's finale presents fourth edition of the Belgrade Debate on Europe, entitled The Possibility of Europe 2.0. Tonight, we gather together some of the most eminent European and regional intellectuals and experts from various fields. In the framework of three debate cycles, we will deal with some of the most important questions that both Europe and Europeans are facing today. The main underlying topic of the fourth Belgrade debate on Europe will be COVID-19 pandemic and its global and more particularly European implications. Kao što verovatno znate, ambasada Savezne Republike Nemačke sa zadovoljstvom podržava večerašnji događaj. As you probably know, the Embassy of the Federal Republic of Germany in Serbia is happy to support tonight's event. Therefore, I invite His Excellency, Mr. Thomas Schieb, to join me on the stage and address the audience. Thank you so much.
Hola, thank you. Thank you very much. Good evening. I'm very glad to be here. I'm pleased to welcome you to the last evening and, if I understand correctly, the central event of this year's KROKODIL festival, the Belgrade debate on Europe, titled The Possibility of Europe 2.0. We are going to listen to three rounds of debate on the future of stabilocracies in the wake of the COVID-19 pandemic, Central Europe between utopian dreams and dystopian realities and the new normal. Ladies and gentlemen, even before the pandemic started, Europe, the European Union, was faced with tremendous challenges. Multilateralism, the international world order under pressure, made it all the more important and makes it all the is making it all the more important for the Europeans to unite, to have more political leverage internationally. At the same time, the situation within Europe has not become any easier. Just to mention the rise of populism and nationalism in a number of European countries. And there is a growing concern that the European idea, that European integration is increasingly losing its appeal for those countries not yet member of the EU family, like the Western Balkan countries, like Serbia. It will not surprise you, I guess, when I tell you that Germany, a founding member of the European Union and currently representing the EU presidency, is deeply convinced that Europe, the EU, will be up to the challenge. And we are not sure whether we even need a Europe 2.0. The EU has overcome many crises before. But of course, this is not a given. We have to work extremely hard for that. And this is what Germany is doing, especially now as presidency of the EU Council. And what we did already achieve is an agreement among 27 member states on the so-called budgetary framework for the next couple of years, because money is needed. We want the EU and Europe to emerge from the current crisis stronger, more united, and with a new sense of solidarity. And this is summed up in our presidency's slogan, Gemeinsam Europa wieder stark machen, together for Europe's recovery, učiniti Evropu ponovo jakom, zajedno. Our efforts to make Europe stronger, more resilient, need to be accompanied by an inclusive, ongoing, open, frank debate on the future of Europe, on what is actually at stake, on what the expectations are of the European people. Tonight's event is a contribution to this, and once again, let me stress that we are very happy to be able to support it. I would like to express my sincere appreciation to the organizers of this event, especially to Milena Beric and Vladimir Arsenievich and their team from KROKODIL Association. Great work. Thank you very much and enjoy the debate. Thank you.
Mnogo hvala u ime celog tima KROKODILA. Many thanks from entire KROKODIL team. U naredna dva sata uživat ćemo u aktivnim razgovorima u okviru tri debatna kruga, kao što je gospodin Šiv spomenuo, koje smo naslovili budućnost stabilokratija u svetlu pandemije virusa COVID-19, centralna Evropa između utopijskih snova i distopijskih stvarnosti i nova normalnost. Svaki debatni krug traje 45 minuta, a radni jezik je engleski. In the next 2 hours, we will enjoy the active discussion during the 3 debate cycles entitled The Future of Stabilocracies in the Wake of COVID-19 Pandemic, Central Europe Between Utopian Dreams and Dystopian Realities, and New Normal. Each debate will last 45 minutes. Working language is English. And something that is really important for us to mention, and probably who were here for the last 3 nights will hear the following, and I will repeat it in Serbian. Due to the severity of economic situation caused by the COVID-19 pandemic, this year's Festival KROKODIL is completely free of charge. Instead of buying tickets, we invite you to make a symbolic donation to account of KROKODIL Association that you can see here. You can make a photo and make a small donation, symbolic one, instead of buying ticket for this festival. So you can read here the note, or you can do it here. We have boxes and our volunteers will pass by. As a return, we will give you a book from our Common Library edition. Zbog težine ekonomske situacije prouzrokovane pandemijom COVID-19, program ovogodišnjeg festivala KROKODIL je potpuno besplatan. Što za vas koji ste prisutni ovde, što za ljude koji prate live stream. Umesto kupovine karata, pozivamo vas da izvršite simboličnu donaciju na račun udruženja KROKODIL, koje možete da vidite iza mene, sa detaljima, ili da izvršite svoju donaciju putem kutija koje ćete vidjeti da volonteri nose ovde na licu mesta. Ovo nam mnogo znači i pomoći ćete organizaciju ovog festivala. Kao poklon mi ćemo vam dati jednu knjigu iz naše edicije Zajednička čitaonica. Ja bih ovime završila i poželam vam da uživate. I will finalize my speech here and invite you to enjoy. Thank you.
Veče, hvala na aplauzu. Ja sam Ljubica Gojgić, novinarka Radio Televizije Vojvodine i zadovoljstvo mi je što ću večeras moći da slušam i da pokušam da pomognem kao moderator prilikom ovoj prvoj zapravo panel diskusiji. Welcome all. This is the first panel discussion, and as you've heard, it is about the future of stabilocracies in the wake of COVID-19 pandemic. Tonight, we have with us Ms. Jelisaveta Blagojević, philosopher and a professor at the Faculty of Media and Communications of the Singidunum University in Belgrade. Good evening.
Hello, good evening.
We also have via video link. Mr. Boris Buden, joining us from, I think, Berlin.
Yes,
indeed. Mr. Buden is a regular dear participant at KROKODIL Festival Debates. And he is a philosopher and cultural theorist. He teaches at the Faculty of Art and Design with the Bauhaus University in Weimar in Germany. Boris, hello. It's nice to see you. It's nice to see you again. It would be great if you could have been here, but it's great to see you and to hear from you even this way.
Yes, thank you. You know, I always miss Belgrade because I spent 1 year in the army in Belgrade. So it always reminds me of on many, many things.
And we also have tonight with us Mr. Florian Bieber, political scientist and historian, director of the Center for Southeastern European Studies at the University of Graz, Austria. And, you know, for those of you who are following Mr. Bieber on Twitter, where he is very, very active, you can find a notification that he is so-called Balkan expert. However, and in spite of his modesty, or in spite of that reference, I think, that somebody else made when speaking about Mr. Bieber, we are very much counting on his expertise on Balkans. Tonight, welcome, Mr. Bieber. Yeah. Okay. Let us start with Elisaveta. Let us start with you, and let us play from the very beginning with the very title of this debate: the future of stabilocracies. That could imply that the present is already there, that stabilocracies are the state of affairs in this part of the world. Would you agree with that?
First of all, thank you everyone for being here tonight. Thank you to KROKODIL team to this invitation. I'm proud to be here tonight, and I hope that I will be able to exchange some thoughts that are relevant for this discussion. Speaking of title, I was scared to death when I saw the title of the panel that I will be talking for many reasons. But at least for the moment, I will just say a few things and then maybe later we will discuss more about that. COVID-19 in the title. COVID-19 is something that it's so frightening today for all of us, the things that we know about it. But what is even more frightening is that we don't know anything about that. So, in one point, we have to talk about something tonight that we don't know anything about. Second thing is future. Future as a term, future is future only if we don't know what is to come. We can talk about anticipation, we can talk about projects, we can talk about different things, but future as such, it's something that it's unknown. So, to make the thing shorter, we have to talk tonight about at least two important terms that we don't know anything about. And I think that we will have difficult task, I think, because rationality will not help us tonight. We have to use new tools to try to articulate these topics.
When you
we need paradox, we need to think in paradoxes, in aporias, etc.
When you say that you were scared and that you are scared with this situation that is totally new and unprecedented, are you scared more about the health aspect of it or the political, economic...
You cannot separate.
Implications.
Mm-hmm. Both politics and life are challenging us today. You know, we cannot separate. Mm-hmm. And another thing, it's stabilocracy, which, honestly speaking, I was not very much into it, but I was reading last few days about it. And this term stability in this context, you know, like it's also very problematic for me because we speak about relations. Relations are never stable. The logic of relation, it's being unstable. Something is always happening, something is changing, you know, like, so to understand stabilocracy, I will wait for my colleagues, you know, like to try to understand better the logic of the term. So in the title, there's so much in the title already that 45 minutes won't be enough, I'm afraid.
Okay, well, we'll have to make it within 45 minutes, I'm afraid. Boris, I read just before we talk a little bit more about how does the stabilocracy look like in this country, in the region, and elsewhere in the EU and the rest of the world. I would like to invite Boris to elaborate briefly, of course, about what you recently said, that you felt and wrote, and you were quoted saying that one historical horizon is closing, and that what we are witnessing today, if I got you correctly, is the end of an era where we believed that neoliberal democracy is there to stay, and that there is no other system or model of reign that could ever turn out to be stronger or more useful. So if the neoliberal democracy is in peril, is stabilocracy the rising star of the new reality?
Thank you for reminding me. Yes, obviously it sounds as though I was commenting on Fukuyama's thesis of the on the end of history, which simply says that end of history does not mean that there will be no events, political conflicts or wars or something like that, but there will be no ideological concept that would be able to challenge liberal democracy. So when I'm saying that the historical horizon is closing, I mean this simple belief that the way into the future, the path into the future is completely clear, and that we don't have to think of any alternatives, just to follow the ideal, and ideal was not in Kantian sense a regulative idea, but actually existing ideal in terms of Western, European, developed liberal democracies and Western capitalism, just, you know, simply to follow the West, and we will sooner or later arrive, I don't know how to explain it, but this horizon is closed. We don't know where to go. This is, of course, what is in peril, is also this appeal of the European Union, which, you know, 30 years ago, it seemed like there is no other alternative, no other option. Europe was, in our minds, understood as a solution to all the problems. Today, Europe and the West is no longer a solution. It is a problem. It is a problem for both, for itself and for us, still caught in this problematic process of the transition, of an eternal transition. Now, it is no longer clear where this transition is heading to. This is one thing. And another thing is, of course, this problem, the concept of stabilocracy, I try to understand it And I was reading about it, and I have certain problems with it, with the concept, because it looks to me that, you know, my first question was, whose stability is it, actually? Whose stability is meant in the concept of stabilocracy? And it's obviously stability of those who look at the Balkans, who look, is it Europe, is it West? I don't know how to call it. But the point is that in this very concept, when we accept it, we immediately, directly identify with the gaze, I would say, with the gaze of master, and asking ourselves, what shall we do so that the master recognizes it? And this is first problem. And the second problem, it sounds after these contractual theories of society, which are very, very, close liberal concepts. And if we think in another in other paradigms, paradigm of solidarity, instead of the paradigm of stability, which evokes these quasi dialectics of security and freedom, liberal dialectics. So this is for me very, very problematic, but let's discuss.
Okay, thank you. Let us involve, this is the perfect moment to involve Florian. Florian, you, people who follow you might think that the copyright on the term stabilocracy or stabilitocracy is actually aligned with you and your friends. You quoted one article that one of your colleagues wrote back in 2016 or 15, I think, and quite nicely it was about Montenegro. Montenegro is the country we are following very closely these days, and especially today. And in that piece that you referred to, stabilocracy was actually described as a state where there is no the point is not on stability. The point is on autocracy and the lack of democracy, right?
Well, yes, indeed. I mean, Srđan Pavlović wrote this article on Montenegro just after, or in the context of the elections last time around. And me and my colleagues used this term to describe a more broader pattern in the Western Balkans. Now, it certainly doesn't imply that there is genuine stability. I mean, I would argue that democracy, participatory democracy, is the precondition for any stability if we see it as a value. What we tried to highlight, and I think Srđan Pavlović did as well, was the idea that it's an authoritarian or semi-authoritarian regime which sells the promise of stability to outsiders. So Boris is absolutely right that the term implies indeed that it satisfies outsiders' demand for stability. And it's not saying that this is a positive thing, but it's in fact, in a certain way, a tool to obscure deficiencies of what I would consider to be liberal democracy. So governments, especially in the Western Balkans, realize that their legitimacy is not just internal, but also external. Having the support from the European Union or other external actors is very important for governments. They seek this support. And so what they have done is they offer the promise of stability. But if stability matters, nobody cares whether Luxembourg is stable because it's an assumption, or Denmark is stable. So the promise of stability is only attractive if there is the threat of instability. So it is in fact those rulers who have to threaten instability to then promise stability. Montenegro, the beginning, or Serbia, tell the outsiders, if you don't support me, there will be chaos, there will be anarchy, there will be fascists on the streets, there will be collapse, you will have an enemy at the gates, you will have Russia in front of your door. So it is this narrative of stability which these governments sell. And this is in a certain way the Western Balkan variant of authoritarian trends we see, whether it's in Hungary, whether it's in Poland, whether it is in Turkey, whether it is in the United States. But each of these regimes has to handle the tension between pretending to be democratic and acting authoritarian in a different way. And I think the Balkan variant is one of stabilitocracy offering to outsiders the fake promise of stability, but also creating instability at the same time.
Florian, help me with this. Okay, if you are selling yourself as the one who can guarantee stability, that I can understand. Why is Europe buying that story?
Well, first of all, it means that they don't care about the other element as much as they used to, which is the element of liberal democracy. So this is, I think, one of the key lessons is that the big weakness of liberal democracies is that the countries, and I would disagree with Boris on that, is that I don't see that weakness so much in the core of Europe, but I see this weakness to try to defend it. So Germany under Angela Merkel is quite a liberal democracy in many ways, but its parties are not defending it outside its own country. So that's, I think, why the closure of the Western Balkan routes for refugees in Macedonia in 2015, this was stabilitocracy, or the promise by Vucic that he will solve the issue with Kosovo, or Montenegro's Djukanovic promising that he will join NATO and be anti-Russian. All of these are examples, and they, at least seem to deliver. I don't believe they always deliver, but they seem to deliver. And I think this is exactly why external partners can live with it. And they don't care enough, or they don't have enough attention to really look at the instability they might bring.
Okay, if Boris or Jelisaveta would like to comment, but Jelisaveta, I would like you to follow up, if possible. We talk about tonight, the all three debates are about the possibility of Europe. Many people in Serbia, at least, find it difficult to understand how is it possible that the whole region that is allegedly getting closer to the EU, a few countries negotiating their way to the full membership, others trying also to get there. How is it possible that if we know that the EU accession process is also about European values, democracy being one of it? How do you see that paradox? Like, you have a region that is described in European Union documents, such as the strategy for Western Balkans, capture state, hybrid regimes or stabilocracies, and on the other hand, they are negotiating their way to the full membership. How do you see that paradox?
First of all, I think we should never forget colonial aspect of it, it's not something that happened today, it's a long history, and I think, that it's part of the problem. I think this negotiation processes, they're a kind of empty shell where two sides are promising to each other that nothing will change. The governments on the one side, European. First of all, there is not one Europe anymore. First of all, European Union is in such a crisis that there are some things. Sometimes I think that there are moments that they can, if we are really partners, they can also be interested to learn some things from. Coming from experience of Western Balkans, first of all, thinking about former Yugoslavia and the First and Second World War. But it's nothing is changing. Look, for how many years nothing is changing? Yes, we look into the Europe because we are neighbors. We don't have, I'm not saying, that European Union and Europe is not our home. But the logic of this guarantees of stability on one side and fulfilling the tasks that Europe is imposing on the Western Balkans, I think, it's empty. It's just a promise of status quo on both sides.
Boris, from the German angle, Germany is very important, undisputedly the most among the equals within the EU, and it is believed that many of our problems are being resolved or cannot be resolved without Germany, without Miss Merkel. So the question that is sometimes asked here is, how do we feel about Miss Merkel and Germany expressing support to the Western Balkan leaders that we see and that Florian describes as a stabilocrats?
This is nothing new for Germany. Germany has been supporting from the very beginning politicians who were not Democrats. Just, you know, I come originally from Croatia. Franjo Tuđman was supported. After all what he wrote in his famous book about Jews, about you know, all this scrap nationalists. And he was, of course, supported. So Germany, this is nothing new. Now that the West, that the most powerful politicians of Europe support non-democratic regimes, politicians, parties, etc. This has been always part of the Western global politics. So this is nothing new. What Jelisaveta said, and I think this is extremely, extremely important. She mentioned the notion of colonialism, just to put it more precisely, neo-colonialism. All our small, little states, allegedly sovereign nation states, are in a sort of a neo-colonial relation to the West and to Europe. And my problem, again, coming back to the notion of stabilocracy, I think there has been always a competition among political elites of a former Yugoslavia, on one side, a liberal, secular, more democratic elites on one side, and nationalist elites on the other side. It was competition for the compradorial role, for the role, who will play the role of compradorial elite to in a best way transmit the interests of the West. And the nationalist elites have won this struggle, this competition, and they are always everywhere in charge. So if you ask for Serbia, what will be the future? Just look into Croatia. This would be some sort of Plenkovicization of Serbia, which means after entering Europe, there will be some process that the right-wing nationalist regime slowly gets some sort of liberal traits, moves towards the so-called center, hoping that it will stabilize it. But these are definitely, you know, we are talking about conclusion, as I'm saying, of a historical process also already on the Balkans with the idea of national sovereignty, etc. This story is over. There will never be any national sovereignty again in what we call former Yugoslavia of this state. And I don't see any loss. I mean, I'm not crying for the loss of national sovereignty. So, more or less, the question whether Serbia will finally join the European Union, I mean, there is no other option for Serbia. And the question which elite will do the job, obviously the one that has been doing the job all the time, which is nationalist elite. They will be slightly refurbished you know, so that you can swallow, that the Europe can swallow it.
Yeah, but the problem there is that I think that the majority here, and according to the polls, the majority in Serbia, over 50% support the Serbia's EU path and are cheering for the membership on one hand. On the other hand, what came with that process is now this story about the situation with the stabilocracy. The stabilocracy that, to be fair, is being criticized, but not as harshly and frequently as people would want. So, from that aspect, the following question might come. What is there for me in this EU accession process if my country is moving away from democracy and being introduced to stabilocracy?
Maybe Florian will, mm-hmm. or shall I?
Yeah, that's if you want to comment on it, and then I'll pass it to Florian by all means.
I have just said there is no. There is no choice. So, but the problem is, of course, how this will end. Why do we call it democracy? Yes, this is one certain regime, but we have it already, you know, elections, etc. It is a sort of democracy with party systems, with corporate media, etc. But what will happen? Is first, which will be good for Serbia to finally lose the illusion of sovereignty, and the real problems would come with, as you know, Jelisaveta mentioned the problem of future. I think future is absolutely clear. According, and it was published like few weeks ago. You know, the new survey on fertility rate in the world as a whole, but also in the Balkans. According to the fertility rate of a woman in Croatia, Serbia, etc., until the end of this century, Serbia will be reduced to the level of Croatia. It will have less than 2 million people. Croatia will be even on the same level. So if this goes on that way, there is no possibility of the survival of the nation, because, you know, these who will survive will be mostly older than 65. So our nations are on verge of biological extinction, plus climate change, plus etc., etc. Europe cannot solve this problem, but Europe can help itself.
Okay.
By
mm-hmm. Yeah. We'll talk about that. We'll talk about that later. Let us include Florian. It would be easy to blame it all on EU or any other member state, Florian. But when it comes to stabilocracy, what are the key? Who is more responsible? Citizens of every of the countries that you mentioned, their lack of capacity to recognize the benefits of democracy and to fight for it, or is it the foreign factor supporting stabilocracies?
Well, I mean, I think it's less about blame, it's more about explaining how it came about. And I think, of course, I mean, Boris mentioned in the 90s already, the governments in the Western Balkans or former Yugoslavia, whatever name you want to use, were more or less undemocratic, authoritarian, and nationalist. I think there was a decade in the 2000s where it seemed that this might change for, you know, more liberal institution building, creating independent institutions, checks and balances, and that basically, that project has been abandoned or has been subverted for the last 10 years. And I think there are many causes. It's the lack, and I think you would say, you said it right, like people want the European Union, but they also don't believe it will happen. Serbia has a very high rate of 40% of citizens who don't believe that they will ever join the European Union. So people have lost their hope that this is going to happen. And of those who think they will join, they think they've lost the hope that this will transform their country. So that certainly makes it easier for stabilocrats, autocrats to say, well, you know, we don't really have to deal with corruption. We don't really have to change because, you know, it's still going to be, you're going to be like Hungary. And that's in the European Union. So I think it's very hard to see that, you know, the European Union is no longer a club of democracies. It has authoritarian governments within it. So it's very hard to in a certain way, make the argument can say, you have to make these difficult transformations, and then you're going to have a democracy which is then accepted into the European Union. People don't believe they're going to join the European Union. Even if they do join, they don't believe it's going to be necessarily democratic. Now, I don't think Serbia or Montenegro or any other country of the region can actually join with the current kind of authoritarian configuration. There's no way. I think many countries in the European Union will veto it because they don't want more Autobots in the European Union. But at the end of the day, you know, it's less about responsibility, but of course the change can only come from within. Outsiders can be less or more helpful. But I don't think this is, they have the agency to change governments or elites. In the crucial moments, they might be helpful, or in crucial moments, they might be destructive, but the kind of main engine has to be citizens from within. Mm-hmm.
Speaking about how do you change, I read on Twitter a couple of days ago one of the Serbia's politicians suggesting that instead of in front of the parliament, the next demonstrations against the regime, Serbian regime should be organized in Brussels, in front of the EU institutions, and he wrote that he believed that that would hurt, that would only then they would understand us better. I guess you will agree that there is a lot of naivety in that approach. But I would like to invite you to comment on that line of thinking that indeed you have to start something in Brussels or in Berlin, in Paris, before you can do anything in Belgrade or in Niš, in Novi Sad.
I would disagree with that. I think, as you already hinted, I think, you know, change and signaling what are the problems has to come from within. And I think if you talk to diplomats or politicians in Brussels, they will often say, well, you know, we deal with the governments in power. We don't pick the presidents or the prime ministers. So we work with whoever is there. And the other problem is, of course, that they will also say, well, you know, we, as long as the governments claim that they're pro-European, no matter how fake this might be, we can work with them. They might still do something which is, you know, which is along our agenda. This might be fake or this might be a facade, but it's very hard for them to criticize a government openly, which is pretending to be pro-European. So in a certain way, you have to make it first a very strong case and show what is the true nature of those governments. But that has to be done within the country. That, of course, has to be communicated to the outside. I think I've often felt that many of the activists in the region are not able or not, you know, kind of able to show the problems of governments to Western interlocutors, who often too naively believe the narrative of governments. But you know, it's partly got to do with the fact that the region is not on the agenda very much. People don't care that much about it. In Brussels, you know, there's maybe two dozens of people who care about the Western Balkans. It's not that everybody's waiting for a protest of Montenegrins or Serbs or Kosovo Albanians or Macedonians to reflect on the problems they have in their country.
Jelisaveta, you wrote during the how is it called, the first wave of pandemic, you were upset with the fact, in an article that you wrote, you were upset with the fact that there was the higher interest imposed on us, that was the health issue, and that it was overshadowing even the right of people to ask questions. it was overshadowing the any kind of debate that is necessary in every society. As it happens to be, we are going to live with COVID-19 for a while. So how does society fight stabilocracy then?
Yeah, I remember. I'm trying to remember what they wrote. It was the moment where every day they were telling us, don't ask these questions because they're politicized, you know, like questions about health, about our life, about our relations, about our fears, and etc. You know, but it's generally the question of different understanding of what is politics and what are relevant, what are important political issues today. We usually talk about so-called everyday politics. Even tonight, you know, like we are talking about power relations, European Union, colonialism, etc. You know, like, but what I wanted to say is that they are pressing political questions that are concerning our lives today. How do we live? How do we live in the uncertainty? Where is community? Do we have community? What is solidarity? Is there any solidarity? How we can pay our bills? How we can help our sick family members, etc. We have to widen this space of what is political relevant. You know, like, and this was the argument, you know, like we are reduced always to the same issues. Because I think, you know, like that much more than stability that any other foreign factors can bring here, we can have if we take more seriously our vulnerabilities, our fears, our community, the way how we live together and how we can live together. So that was the idea.
Boris, you were in the same article that I already referred to that was very interesting. You placed the thesis that we've heard very often here that crises, global crises, are our chance. And we often comment how pretentious it is to believe that economic crisis or political crisis in the world could serve us. But you said that in a way, people of ex-Yugoslavia countries could draw important conclusions and important lessons from this situation, that they should turn perhaps, while still looking towards the EU, that they should perhaps try to reconnect better between themselves and to get themselves prepared to fight many fights on their own.
Yes, precisely. This is the very essence of this problem. As I said from the very beginning, the concept of stabilocracy comes from this tradition, which is more liberal contract or concept of contract theory of society. I would prefer the paradigm of solidarity, and this is first thing that I'm suggesting, that we think more in terms of solidarity. And this is, after this discussion about European Union, about this question, which obviously it cannot be answered now, but we have, after 30 years, actually enough experience on both sides of the European Union, on the side of Croatia, for instance, but on the side of those who are not yet in, to not think, no longer think in terms of illusions. On either side, there is no reason for further illusions. The Europe won't make Serbia, after it finally becomes the member, stable, rich. The capital won't come. On quite the contrary, educated people will leave. There are enough jobs. There are in the European Union. Just look what is happening in Bulgaria and Romania. This is the future. But now, what is most important? We saw that our concepts of national sovereignty has failed. We are living all in failed nation states that have lost their sovereignty on all possible levels. So we should start to think how to find a way to each other, how to find forms of solidarity, social and political solidarity within what used to be former Yugoslavia, beyond this constant struggle for recognition from the outside, you know, Europe, West, etc. This struggle for recognition simply exhausted us completely and has led to nothing. So, but we must find again our own language and new concepts of solidarity beyond the concept of sovereign nation states.
Let me just ask you, and that's the final question for all the panelists. A famous Serbian and Montenegrin musician said that dreams about democracy are for those who earn more than, I think, 1,000 euros. Those who live on 300 cannot afford discussions about how do you fight stabilocracy. Our everyday's experience shows us that they would they surrender, actually. Could there be a democracy in the Western Balkans? Could there be, if we remain on this level of economy?
I would just use the concept of Branko Milanović, economist, probably Serbian or American, I don't know. Entering the global liberal meritocratic capitalism, which is obviously the fate, entering this, we enter also the major problem of it, and this is the increasing gap between rich and poor. This is the question of inequality, and this is how I am translating your question. We have to ask again, openly, politically, the question of equality. Equality within the European Union, equality between the so-called rich and poor, the question of social solidarity. And this is, for me, the next agenda in which we might find the level of solidarity in fighting for more equality.
Thank you. Florian, our friend and colleague Dusan Reljic, who now sits in Brussels representing respectable German institute, is writing very much about this economic element, calling on the EU to pay more attention to this economic basis for building a solid democracy in the region. What do you say?
Well, I mean, certainly, I would agree that if you have a certain income, it's easier to worry, or you have more time. I mean, it's also the whole idea of being able to more worry about environment and all of the other things which really matter, whether it is global inequalities, global environmental problems, when you can afford it. But, you know, we see people protesting and going on the streets in countries which are poor and people where people are not well off. So I think the assumption that you have to be rich to care about democracy is wrong. I don't think that's true. I think it's easier. The pressure is stronger, but why? Because people compare themselves to others. If you live in an undemocratic neighborhood, it's hard to imagine living in a democracy. If you live in a democratic neighborhood, prosperous democracies, it's easier to imagine that that's possible. So it's very much about what ideas of your future are imaginable, and you think about them because you look at your neighbors and you look at others and you're saying, well, can we live like them? If your neighbors are more democratic but poorer, then maybe you don't want to follow that example. Or if your neighbors are wealthier and more democratic, then maybe you feel like this is something which is achievable. So I think it's too simplistic and deterministic to say it's only about money and it's about resources, but it's about many in the government. You know, if you look in Serbia, Montenegro, they might say, well, we're not that much worse off than our maybe more democratic neighbors. So why really bother? Or the same in Hungary. They say, well, our Orban might be corrupt, but we're not worse off than we are in Slovakia or in the Czech Republic. So what's the problem? So I think this is the challenge, is the seeing the options and seeing the need to take a risk, because in an authoritarian regime, there's a risk to deal with it. It's easier to live with it. And that's the regimes always make it sure to make it easier to arrange yourself with the reality of them. And that's the question of when citizens feel like they cannot live with that regime anymore.
Thank you. Jelisaveta, would you like to add something?
A lot is already said, but democracy is much more than economy. I mean, I need to say that. And it would be great that we can live in much better standard, all of us, you know, like, but not by taking credits and money from European Union and other organizations, you know, like in order to achieve that image that we live better, you know, like what is task for us is to make circumstances that we can earn our money. Speaking of money, but what is important for me, democracy is much more than economy.
Thank you very much, Jelisaveta, Boris, Florian. It was great talking to you tonight. Thank you very much. I hope you are satisfied. Stay with us, because in just a few minutes another debate is to start, and it is about Central Europe between utopian dreams and dystopian realities. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming to this evening discussion on Europe, and on not only on Europe but also on European Union. There's been a lot of confusion. I'm almost allergic to confusing Europe and the European Union. It seems that people from European Union put a copyright on that, but I think we do sit in Europe right now, although this is not part of the intergovernmental organization that is called the European Union. But Of course, let's keep in mind this terminological difference. There was a lot of discussion already about terms we use in order to analyze our current situation. Tonight with me, we have a guest from Poland, Michal Kozlowski. You will very soon find out about his impressive biography. He is a philosopher that is very much familiar with the Balkans for personal and intimate reasons, but also someone who has been very much connected with the philosophical scene here in the Balkans, and especially in Serbia. Some of you maybe follow his comments that he publishes often in the Le Monde Diplomatique and other outlets concerning specifically the condition of, say, Poland or Central Europe or Eastern Central Europe. And also we are having with us Katarina Pejović, who is joining us online from Croatia, or more precisely, I guess, from Dalmatia right now. And we are very happy that he can come and actually bring some insights from the Balkanic perspective, or from Croatian perspective, which of course is somewhere in between Central Europe and the Balkans. There is another debate about actually where we are, where Central Europe starts, where it ends, where the Balkans starts, where they end. Why do we see it in opposition? And of course, just to conclude this introductory part, we are perfectly placed here in Belgrade to discuss these issues, as you see, geographically pretty much part of Central Europe, although no one here refers often to themselves as a Central European country. Maybe in Vojvodina they do or feel part of that, but somehow it seems that the Central Europe as a term lost its appeal. It's been this in the 70s and the 80s. It's been this region that's been famous for producing great intellectual and great writers. Somehow, we not so many of them are coming from this region over the last 30 years. It's been the celebrated concept of something lost in the First World War, lost in the Second World War. There have been a lot of nostalgia for good old Habsburg times. There and also a lot of tears shed about the tragic story of Central Europe that somehow decided in 89 to end with a state socialist regime there and enter or rejoin Europe again. At least this was the discourse. Maybe utopian dreams that we heard in the title were part of this sort of rejoining Europe. Now, what actually happened? I know I'll start with Michal, and I know it's difficult to explain in 5 minutes what actually happened in Central Europe, but since we often, as was mentioned in the panel, previous panel, we often talk to the West. There's not so many exchanges between various parts of Eastern or Central or Southeastern Europe. We are very often pretty much oriented to talk to the West. And therefore, we do not know, most people do not know actually what happened, what tremendous changes happened, say, in Polish society. And why then we do the messages we get over the last 10 years are mostly related to the rise of certain type of populism, nationalist, reactionary, conservative, religious. It seems that the Poland places itself at the forefront of a new conservative reactionary movement in Europe, with a lot of influence, very direct influence to the events in Croatia, for instance. So can you just give us an insight, short one, about the country where you live and work?
Thank you very much, Igor. Thank you, KROKODIL, all of you. Well, let me first make a very brief declaration statement. I'm a Marxist. Why is it important? We won't be talking about that, but some things I will be saying now may sound to many very un-Marxist. So I wanted to make this this point. I mean, I'm a Marxist in a precise sense of a term, in which I consider that Karl Marx's account of capitalism as exposed in Das Kapital is in the big lines accurate and actual. And despite of that, I'm going to say a few words bitter about our Central Europe, Central and Eastern Europe, Central and Southern Europe. Of course, those lines are blurred, but no more than the ones of Europe itself. You know, that the concept first appears in 15th century, but it takes another 300 years that before the concept of Europe becomes a dominant one, and we think that we are cultivating thousands or 2,000 years of European tradition. No, of course not. So, well, for Central Europe and for the Balkans, of course, it's also moving. But then, why I wanted to say something bitter? Because I've experienced a lot, and I keep experiencing, and even we heard it in the previous debate from our distinguished colleagues and guests, the very strong idea of exteriorization of our malaise and also of our sins and horrible things we did. Exteriorization, putting them on others. I mean, of course, paradigmatic model that was invented in the 90s, the them were the Nazis, them, and the communists, also them. They were always them. Who did that? And we were almost, you know, I mean, there was a lot of Anglo-Saxon scholarship, notably Timothy Snyder, who very much went native and sort of brought up this discourse. And I think now there is this book that I would give some... Yeah, but it's a good book of German historian Philipp Thayer on the dark side of nation states, which mainly focuses on Central Europe, which he understands, I think, quite correctly in this context, as something stretching from Tallinn in Estonia to Thessaloniki at the Aegean Sea. Our Eastern Europe is defined as a magnificent social laboratory. We are not provincial. They were learning from us. It's a formidable social laboratory of ethnic cleansing. It's a place where nationalism took its most radical and purest forms. Nationalism, I understand it very simply. Nationalism is the idea that all political organizations should coincide with ethnical unity, that at best state organization be homogeneous, and there should never ever be ethnic, cultural, identitarian difference between the governing and the governed. And this idea was not an obvious thing in Central and Eastern Europe before 1918. To the contrary, there were a lot of people among the Serbs, among the Croats, among the Poles, among Russians, those Russians who wanted independence for all the countries depending on Russia, even Ukraine, there were many. And we launched ourselves into this affair in 1914, and we never got out of it. I think it's quite important to say it in Belgrade, because now, of course, having a short historical memory, which is normal for humans, having the short historical memory implies that we think we blame Yugoslavia as if it was the only one who did it, who sort of burst it up and cleansed itself and produced a plethora of homogeneous national identities. No, it was actually the last part of Central Europe who tried to do otherwise, but then ultimately failed, only that after the time everybody was already failing. So we have dozens of millions of displaced and millions of killed within the process, and not of totalitarian one, not of dictatorship, of nation building, including democratic nation building, like Czechoslovakia, yeah? Like partly Poland in the early 20s. We tried to, but we failed to find a formula of different polity, non-ethnic polity. And you know, the others followed example. Now, of course, we are tiny part of the world, but I think we were intellectually very important. And of course, then it moved away, but now Middle East is taken by it. India took it over in the 40s. Indonesia took it. Supposedly Africa is the continent most spurred from ethnic cleansing. But if they keep on following us, it's going to be the biggest disaster we heard of.
That was rather a big picture.
That was a big one, too big. Sorry.
And the way to avoid speaking about Poland was, but we'll come back to it. And thank you for of course mentioning this nation building and nationalist project. And yes, we were latecomers. For Yugoslavs were latecomers. They did try. We did try to preserve a heterogeneous, to build a heterogeneous model, the federal one, and then join the failed model of the nation state, as Boris Budin put it, quite lately. And when we talk about dystopia already happened here. It happened in the 90s. It happened through war and this total destruction before this region was ready to join this new neoliberal global order that was already in place, and quite firmly so. And now we are facing a different trajectory, obviously, than the country like Poland that obviously in the last 30 years did not go through the events that were so tragic in Polish and Central European history. And yet we find ourselves faced with the dominance or hegemony of the good old nationalist religious ideology. So now we're bringing the Croatian example. As I said, Katarina is joining us online, and of course been very, Katarina is a good friend, also fellow academic, author of very important theoretical books, who decided to do something that many intellectuals usually don't do, which is to jump into political arena and to bring a different discourse. And so far, so good. Katarina been elected to Croatian parliament, which is in itself a good news. But now I'll ask you to tell us what would be your thoughts about what we heard. What is the country called Croatia? Boris Budin tried to say something, but isn't it's a country that in a way everybody expected to follow Hungarian and a Polish model? Not yet. There's no authoritarian populist leader, a country split between left and right, and it's even possible, now at least some good news coming from Croatia, to elect so-called radical left into the parliament.
So, thank you, Igor. I'm very pleased to see you again. Unfortunately, not in flesh, but I'm in Zagreb right now, and I'm glad to see you at least in this form. Thank you for this introduction. It was really very unlike decision for one academic and professor to join politics. It is not something that is often happening in Croatia, unfortunately, I would say, because my colleagues still have some positions that allow them to speak freely about important subject. And the second thing they have the conceptual model very often, and Marxist model to understand what is happening to us, because we are deeply engaged in myths about economy that you stated before, that myths that we expected to come through when we once joined EU. Unfortunately, these myths are obviously today overthrown. But we don't have a conceptual apparatus to understand and to describe this form of inequality and this form of uneven and evenness in Europe today. So I think that the first thing that we need to do, and I can talk about statistics and where is Croatia regarding EU center, EU countries of Western Center, but we all know that Croatia is very poor country today and that we are not doing well. So I will skip that. We have very high unemployment. We have we are first in EU for precarious employment. We have very low wages, etc., etc. But what I'm thinking about, what I think that we need to understand, it's why. Because what is usually interpreted in our region, I would say, as a positive model would be one Western central rich country. We would usually take Sweden or Germany or a rich state like that, and we only need to develop ourselves to that model. But it is not so simple, and we need to understand why. And economic rules block equality between periphery and center of Europe, between underdeveloped countries of the South and East Europe on the one hand, and rich countries of the Western center on the other hand. The rule of uneven development is to be understood precisely. And I think that this is the moment when left parties step in. So political and economic asymmetry between the center and the periphery of Europe, this disbalance of the EU structure needs to be understood. So Greek economists started to warn on this asymmetry between countries when Greek economy fell, we all know, into even a great recession after following imposed austerity measures. On the simplest level, what was happening to Greece today is happening to Croatia also. On the simplest level, we must say that there are rules that are blocking the measures from the state or local government that could improve local peripheral economies, and those rules cannot be overcome. I won't go into details. We all know that we have the Treaty on the Functioning of European Union, that we have treaties that are blocking some interventions from the state, but the market functions in this treaties as ultimate horizon of politics. Well, any state and local government state is seen as a threat to distort competition and free trade rule. However, we need to understand that there are practically no examples of country in history developing in entirely open market and without protectionism, at least in initial phases of development. And Croatians needs, and also other nations in these regions need to step aside from this mythology of Western rich countries model that we need to follow. We have to understand this asymmetry.
Yes, this is interesting to now to take into example the Polish case. So obviously, big economy, 40 million people. Semi-peripheral economy, the country whose economic situation, unlike the one of Croatia, Bulgaria, and Latvia or other country, is relatively good. Now, what that means, that's another question. But there's been a lot of economic activities. Is it mostly thanks to the proximity to German market or other factors? Doesn't matter. And so we got back to the question of economy and democracy, whether a certain level of prosperity is good for democracy, that's been mentioned in the last panel. Now again, this Polish puzzle. Okay, it seems to be doing relatively well for a large parts of Polish population. For the one who do not do well, they go abroad. Why then there is hegemony of a right-wing nationalist ideology, with an anti-enlightenment agenda, how we could then explain this?
Okay, then Poland is a very nice country, maybe not in itself, but for a social scientist, it is marvelous. Because, like, it has many characteristics that put in question the myths and dogmas, what the French call idées reçues. And precisely, of course, most of the Polish left understood the pretty abrupt change of government, actually change of the regime and political system that we witnessed in 2015 in classical terms. You know, neoliberals came, they privatized, they fired people, they deregulated market, deindustrialized the country, and then the people, of course, turned to nationalists because they were seeking consolation and trust, and they believed their social and economic promises. Only that it completely doesn't work with Poland, and I think it is also very questionable that this explanation works elsewhere, but even to some extent it may. Because, again, I'll refer myself to the French term I like very much, les 30 glorieuses, the 30 glorious years of capitalism, supposed 30 glorious years of capitalism after World War II, that were created those welfare states, Western European in particular, and all that, and then came the bad times. Well, of course, they have very much mystified the beauty of those 30 glorious years, but I would say Poland had its 30 glorious years at its culminative point in 2015. Because despite the fact that the 90s really were difficult, with high unemployment, with low growth, what happened after? Of course, I understand what happened from a Marxist global point of view. Of course, Poland was integrated into the world globalizing capitalistic market. But it wasn't done like it was done to Chile. It wasn't done like it was done to Mexico. It wasn't done like it was done to Argentina, which had never worked even properly. It was done in a German way. Reasonably, orderly. It was a neoliberalism, I agree, but unlike other neoliberalism. Why? I mean, one factor you mentioned, of course, the very deep integration. I'm not even sure if economically we can speak of Poland. If Poland is a semi-peripheric country now economically, it is the closest to the center you can get. Because it's true that it's one of the engines of the German export Weltmeister and all those things. But then the second one was that precisely in this year, we received the accumulative direct money transfers from the EU to Poland reached 110 billion euros, right? Enormous money that was most of it either agriculture, which means reaching the impoverished countryside in one way or another, reinforcing local elite, it's true, but, or on the other hand, simply maintaining social services, maintaining the state, maintaining infrastructure, it was investment. And third factor was, of course, the cultural evolution. I remember the times when being Polish in Germany would be mostly associated with the slogan, heute gestohlen, morgen in Polen. Yeah, so like, your car is stolen today and tomorrow you can find it behind the Polish. It's completely changed because there is a free movement policy that is, this is for the first time after the Imperial Rome, so many people got an equal legal status. So many people of different nations, different cultures, religions and wealth. So I don't think it applies. What happened in 2015 is very easy. You can follow it really with quantitative sociological data. In March 2015, extremely bad conservative president Bronisław Komorowski had 70 or 60% in the polls of support. Then the refugee crisis started and he lost significantly because the new discourse and the new division line in the Polish politics appeared. It was not who likes to take refugees, who doesn't, because nobody wanted them really, but zero refugees policy. Zero refugees was the offer of the extreme right, and this was embraced by the majority, clear majority by the Polish population. This was the stake of those elections. Since then, the government with its media apparatus developed several other
pogrom strategies against other groups. It's true. But this is, and this is why I wanted to say that what I said before was not disconnected to Poland. I don't think you can build a part of the world on ethnic cleansings and nationalism and get away with it. Because, of course, the thing with refugees was a, despite what you think of it, was a total paranoia. We were talking about 3,000 people. And it changed the regime in Poland. For how long, it's whether for good, I don't know. We'll see.
Well, this of course, there's a lot of difficulties in obviously understanding these processes. Because what you eloquently described, it's, you know, we could be even envious of Poland today. That certainly changed. And on the other hand, it was possible to sell the story about the refugees who don't even want to come to Poland to millions of people at the elections. So therefore, a clear disconnect between the economic situation and the political agendas. Now, going back to Katarina and the question of say Croatian position. Of course, we don't want to turn this discussion into discussion about pathologies of the others. Yeah, but we don't have a Serbian counterpart. We would leave to the audience to, of course, draw conclusion because many processes are similar. Favorite game in this country is, of course, to see Croatian pathologies. So let's work a bit more on these Croatian pathologies. Katarina addressed them very eloquently in a presidential elections debate and of course, got many sympathies also here in Serbia for her very firm views on this. Now, how is it possible that so many people, obviously not two-thirds, but at least half of the country, still believes in nationalist lies that have been told over and over again for 30 years, although the situation right now in Croatia is comparably worse than it was during socialism and is not getting any better. Although the country, the nationalists in power for so many years, over less, for majority of these 30 years, robbed the country. Everyone knows this. The major conservative party, nationalist party, is the most corrupt one. Everyone knows this. And yet, they could still win elections. And yet, their ideology is still the dominant one.
Yes, I agree. The major concern of the left here is how to translate the nationalism into economy, to put it simple. Because what is dividing us is a class conflict, but it is addressed in... So what are the reasons for this... wrong addressing of the problem could be debated on, but it is obvious that class conflict is transformed into the false nationalist conflict. So the first question and first task for the left is to address this disfranchisement of the majority, economical, material disfranchisement of the majority, and to address those issues in different way. And I think that the poor results of the so-called left, and when we call when we say left, we are talking about social democrats that can easily be described as extreme center, to use Tariq Ali's term in this context.
Something happened. You're frozen now. Well, let's hope that we can resolve this technical difficulty. All right, we...
Croatia was cut off, supposedly.
Yes, so obviously, so We will wait for Katarina to join and to reconnect with us, and we can continue. Okay, is it okay right now?
Yes.
Okay, go
right,
ahead.
Right
finish.
Wing explanation of what's happening. Sorry. Unfortunately, internet connection is today in Zagreb experiencing some major differences, difficulties. So maybe this will happen again. But what I needed to say is that social democrats turn out to be what we really must address to as extreme center, which means that the ones who were describing themselves as leftists became to be really socially and socially neoliberals, so to put it simple. So they proposed and imposed very very harsh neoliberal measures when they are at power. So what needed to be done is to propose authentic left descriptions of what is happening to a poor majority. So if I have enough time to describe what is, or maybe you have some question for Michal, but I would like to describe what is happening to us in this region. If Igor, if you are proposing something else, please do so.
Yeah, if you want to go for one more minute, then we will go to the final round of questions that will be more oriented toward the future.
Okay, I only wanted to quote or to describe what Branko Horvat described, a very famous Croatian economist, described in very interesting way and very futuristic way, I would say, that is very precise description of what is happening today in this region. So he said that one of the first motive for disintegration of Yugoslavia and separation of Croatia and Slovenia as the as richest countries in Yugoslavia was the belief that the more developed parts of former state will be more developed because they will be relieved if Yugoslavia won't if Yugoslavia will come to its end, because they will be relieved from the burden of financing underdeveloped regions as, for example, Kosovo. So what is happening today, Croatia plays the role of Kosovo, of the EU. So we need to understand some consequences of that. Now, Croatia is very poor, as we all know, but behind this widespread prejudice, this economic logic is really different truth that we need to address. When the underdeveloped receive direct subsidies, most of it will be spent on the goods and services coming from developed regions. So through the multiplication process, says Horvat, the growth of gross domestic product will be higher than the value of subsidy in developed regions. So this now decision to rush into EU was pointed with with a belief that is totally untrue. So we are really need to understand that this region will profit from some kind of economic connections. Let's say it broadly, not to come to this in detail. Yeah.
So. Since this is a very short format of 45 minutes, but we should address the question of future and also how you see the current discussion about the future of Europe and general of the European Union. Obviously, the French would not agree with the Poles, and there is the idea that things should stay as they are, that already the mechanism that exists within the EU and with its external policies, especially in the Western Balkans, are good as they get, and that one could use them to actually solve the obvious problems or the malaise that we can feel today in the European Union. And another idea comes mostly from Macron, which is the idea of Europe of several circles, where obviously there will be those who make decisions, the core groups, and then there will be another ring, and Croatia will be in the third or fourth ring, and Serbia tomorrow will be in the seventh ring of the decision-making process, in order to basically expose the differences that already exist and makes the possibility, makes the political machine function. Obviously, there is a impression that the fact that Eastern European countries joined the EU in such a great number stopped institutionally the European Union, and obviously there are differences in how we perceive future democracy, values, and even economy. And then there is this option that is very popular in the Eastern Europe, but it's also extraordinarily powerful in Western Europe, and there Eastern Europe maybe is an avant-garde, which is the national sovereignty. We heard from Boris Budin today that it's a myth, that it failed, but it's still extraordinarily powerful, the idea that we should go precisely back to the nation states to construct the Europe of nation states in which there won't be migrants and people who are coming from various sides, in which the nationalist dream will be realized to the fullest and some sort of cooperation will be established in Europe. Now, how do you see these discussions? And of course, even more ambitious question, what for you would be that Europe 2.0?
Two things I'd like to say. Well, first of all, of course, this talk of a Europe of sovereign states, it's simply bullshit. It's like nobody believes in it. It's just a propaganda. It's a PR gimmick of those little satraps and the ingenuity of Viktor Orban, because you say Germany is important in Europe, but you like very often have an impression that Hungary is more powerful, because he understood that he can get away with it basically perfectly with pretty little resources. He's not Vladimir Putin, you know. They use this talk, but of course, I'm not sure they even want it. This is just a talk to mobilize the electorate. And on the other hand, of course, I would say what is more dangerous for Europe as a polity, as a political construction, is Northern European fiscal populism. I know that Greeks and Italians are not angels, but if you have a common currency, you must have common debt. Otherwise, it's really daydreaming about politics. But I don't know, can it succeed? What I like about, of course, I don't care about Europe. I mean, I care about humanity. Europe doesn't interest me, but there is something about Europe, of course, being non-ethnic, monogenetic state, and trying to work out within some other framework. I know bourgeois framework, but you know what is good about Europe in this sense? That unlike all other empires, it is born out of a defeat. Out of a double defeat and even attempt of a suicide of this continent that in the 1940s Europe successfully achieved. So, of course, I mean, some kind of federalism, but this is not the most important question today, because, and I think Katrina is right in many ways, you know, in a way, here lies the core of the problem. On the one hand, the real discussion, the one Karl Marx always wanted, it's between us and them, us the left and then the liberals. The liberals represent, they have their paradigm, which is adequate to the capitalist world, and we want to go through it. We want to be more enlightened and better than that. But now, more than ever, we see this necessity, because now capitalism doesn't only threaten the working class, it threatens the planet. We really need to work out a new law of value, and we are completely nowhere in that. And for that, we need to fight the liberals. But at the same time, we have a tendency, I think we also inherited from Marx, because he also believed that the real ones are the liberals and socialists. And the conservative right wing, not even talking about populist right wing, no, this is just a supplement of history that will soon disappear. No, there is an elephant in the room. You know, I read an interview with Nancy Fraser a year ago or two, a distinguished scholar and left-wing activist as well, and she said in this interview that she feels somewhat of a satisfaction when Donald Trump is smashing liberals. And then I said to myself, I don't. I feel fear. Maybe she's still too much privileged to let herself such satisfactions.
Katerina, what would be your take on the situation in European Union and Europe, and as I said, what would be the way forward?
Now we opened too many questions for 15 minutes to answer, but yes, we have this discussion between us and them, and a liberal description of the problem is false and wrong. And maybe this is why Nancy Fraser put this in this context. But we need to solve the problem in most democratically and I would say openly socialist way, because the need for democratic socialism or alternative to this model of European economy need to really overcome those problems that are producing radical right. So to cut the story short, the best way would be, and the only way would be, to transform this capitalist economy. But we cannot do it in one day. So we need to reform European Union to overcome such differences. The first thing and minimal transformation would be that EU becomes fiscal union with a shared budgetary policy, and with Corona shares we saw how this model of overcoming differences won't work, because a rich capitalist center won't agree on that matter. So also, it would need to we would need to see transfer of technology from developed countries to underdeveloped countries, and limiting foreign import and protection of domestic export of underdeveloped. Those three points, I would say, would be minimum political and economic steps for overcoming these differences and these problems.
Well, it seems that we are running out of time that been allocated to this discussion. Obviously, we opened a lot of problems that are absolutely crucial. Many of them are economic. The others are need an understanding of a big picture, historical and contemporary. That is very often forgotten in these everyday news and everyday political discussions. And unfortunately, what we heard today, thanks to our guest, is not so much present in the public discussions. either is present in academic circles or rather smaller theoretical and cultural circles, and does not really get so easy to the mainstream. Moving these discussions to the mainstream, and this was one attempt, and thank you for helping in this task, would be maybe something that to be done rather in a short term. Maybe it's possible, or let's just believe for today that discussions and theoretical insights could provoke a concrete political action into making a different future. Thank you, Katarina, and thank you, Michal, and thank you all.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Katarina.
Thank you.
Hello, everybody. I'm really happy to be here tonight. My name is Uroš Kočadinac, and this is the third part of the debate. I'll be your moderator for the debate, and we'll talk about the new normal. What is the new normal? And I'm going to talk with Daria. I'm going to talk with Miguel and Ole. Thank you all for being here with us tonight. Your connection is working. Everything's fine. Okay, great. So, let's start with this term, new normal. I think it emerged more than 10 years ago, and it's kind of old new normal, and then we have this new normal and neo new normal and the next normal and all these post new normal situations that we live in today. So my first question for you, Daria, is going to be: what is the new normal? Is it really new? Is it normal? Yeah.
I don't know if other people saw the sitcom called The New Normal, which actually, when I was looking up the term, I was fascinated to see it. It's like a sitcom from 2012, and it's about, Wikipedia says, it's about a happy gay couple which gets a surrogate mother for their kid, and then the reactions of all the normal people around the new normal situation. And what is like the new family. And for me, it's really fascinating to think about this application of the term. If we think about it today, and if we think about COVID in terms of how language is appropriated very fast, and how the new normal basically implies that there is a normal, which is a normal for everyone equally, and that the normal is distributed equally, right?
And the new is distributed.
And the new is distributed equally. So for me, for example, because I'm a digital practitioner with a practice in like critical technologies, thinking about terms like new are always associated with a neoliberal concept of technology, which comes to save the world. And basically, it is a narrative called the impact narrative, where everything that is produced is in a continuation, in a very linear way of perceiving the world, where science will come to save us, like hard science, like the science that should save us from any health crisis that we're in. So it's very interesting to have this term, which is very clean and scientific,
in a world where science is under question at the current moment. And then the normal, if we think about the new normal, which is something we are already living in, it's not referring to the future, it's referring to this moment, post-critical crisis moment. Who is the new normal actually protecting? Because if we think about systems and the normal meaning...
Whose interest does it serve?
Yeah, and like if we are protected now, if the new normal seems like something that should be lived, it's a continuation, it's like a continuous process, it's not something like a short crisis, but it's a state that we can survive in and we are protected. Who is protected in this state? Because the ones that were protected in the old normal can maybe be protected, but do we really want to have the world that was before this crisis? Because this is actually the point where we have when I say we, that's already problematic. The world has an opportunity to rethink, but to rethink and recalibrate in many places. So there is not one new normal which can feed all, because it only feeds the ones that are already fed.
Yeah, thank you. I agree with what you said. And now I'm thinking about, you know, you're saying there are a lot of new normals. There are a lot of different, you know, new normals. But at the same time, we live, you know, in a connected world that is deeply connected with the internet, with technology, with servers, with cables, with all these like Wi-Fi things, and with financial infrastructure and all the rest. So I somehow feel that at the same time, we have this fragmentation of everything. We're living in our little homes. Everybody's fragmented, but at the same time, we are somehow talking about the world more often than we used to. We are talking about, you know, this universal condition that we all share. Is it a paradox, or is it in technological terms, in societal terms, in terms of data, in terms of people, in terms of censorship, in terms of privacy, in terms of the way we, you know, live our everyday, in terms of everyday hacks?
Yeah, the most fascinating thing, besides people even wanting to have a conversation now, which is also again on some Zoom and listening to people talking and talking to other people online, I mean, everyone is probably mostly wanting to escape somewhere in nature and just be silent from all the talking. But the generating of data in the last months has been immense, of course. Everyone knows that. I mean, you can feel it intuitively, right? Because you're much more online, you have to do all your work online. So you're producing much more data. And this data is extremely valuable because it's becoming more and more intimate. It's becoming data that you weren't giving out before. And there were some really interesting things that happened, as they do with technology, which is, again, this impact narrative implies that technology is like nature. It just works. It's just there. Everything is seamless. And it is intuitive for you so that you do not have to do anything.
Do you think it's finally the time to make this idea technology is not neutral, it's not objective, for this idea to become mainstream?
It started showing...
Will it be mainstream?
The thing is that every crisis is an opportunity for this to show.
Yeah.
So, for example, what happened and that was really interesting was the application of artificial intelligence in content moderation. Immediately when the crisis started in March and April, what happened was that every company was sending people back home and people were working from home. So all the content moderators, the people that need to police data, basically, observe data and say, like, oh, this is hate speech. Oh, this cannot go, blah, blah, blah. They were also sent home. And instead of, and they were not given a pay. They were just basically sacked. And what was applied was artificial intelligence. That wasn't tested sufficiently.
They took our jobs.
They took our jobs. They took the jobs that no one really wants to do. If you look at the surveys on people doing content moderation, a lot of them went into therapy and like really had like post-traumatic syndrome stress, like very serious, almost like coming back from war. So it's one of the most terrible jobs that there is, actually. But in terms of algorithms, what is fascinating is that very fast, I mean, in a couple of days, it showed that the way it was choosing which content was appropriate and not was random. It was just by some keywords, which were very, like, not applicable, as you can imagine, if you do a little bit of
artificial intelligence. It's really technological, but at the same time, it's not hard science. It's really soft science, is it?
It's not even science. It's just applying a very simple rule to a very complex scenario, which happens often with artificial intelligence. So a lot of content got censored. A lot of legitimate journalist content was taken off. A lot of so we're talking about Twitter, we're talking about YouTube, we're talking about Facebook, and most of the dominant platforms, basically. But one of the other things that was also interesting in this period was that by generating all this data, we have some advancements that just happened very recently as a, let's say, side effect. Well, in terms of science, they would say breakthrough.
Do you think it's because of, do you think it was affected by COVID-19?
Yeah, definitely, because of the generating of data, because the amount of textual content that people wrote. By textual content, I mean texting apps, Google searches, everything that you type in every app. So, like, a lot of content that you would consider is personal and that is yours and your applications is just, you know, goes into all these, like, data analysis algorithms, which do not serve for anyone to track you personally. They go to feed something like GPT-3. And GPT-3...
So what is GPT-3?
It's well, you can also tell us what is GPT-3. It's a continuation of the GPT-2 model, which is an already generated model for text analysis that was already fed by a lot of input from English language, usually.
So you could say automated literature.
In a way. It produces automated literature, and what happened now is that it's producing extremely good automated literature. GPT-2 was able to produce sentences that made some sense, but GPT-3 can actually produce a science article, a speech, any genre that you give it and that you feed it with. Hate speech.
Propaganda speech.
Yeah, it actually wrote a response to philosophers criticizing GPT-3. And this response is astonishing, the quality of the language. This just happened a month ago, I think, or a few weeks ago.
So it's really new, the new normal.
The new normal is technological advancements that go hand in hand with a crisis.
And at the same time, this crisis of intimacy, I found myself during these months of quarantine, like living in these like four walls, three regular walls, and the fourth wall is the screen, and like feeling the need just to hug people, to go into the street and randomly hug random people. So it's a crisis of intimacy on one hand, and this automation of every kind of media output, writing, images, music, everything else.
Did you mean opportunity of crisis?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, automated writing is also something that is extremely interesting because we're not really aware in this process of naturalizing technology, we're not really aware of how fast changes happen. And only in a certain moment when you're writing an email and you get all these suggestions for how to end your sentence, you can just go, you know, and click forward. Yeah, of course, no problem.
How to save ourselves from this neoliberal wow, from this wow effect of this kind of technologies? Like the future is here, the progress is here.
Currently, there is a lot of reaction happening from communities that are tech communities, which have more time to do development, and which have enough power to distribute resources. And I do think it is one of the moments when open source tools can become more accessible to people, accessible in terms of being more wow, not being something that you just look at and you're like, how do I use this?
And also be more open, be more democratic, be more socially owned, be more accessible to people, be more accessible to writers, if we're talking about these writing technologies, but also everybody, basically.
Of course, because we really need to be aware that all of these situations like COVID are used by huge corporations to change policies. So maybe you noticed, maybe you didn't, but already like in March and April, all of these companies were sending emails like, we're changing our policies to protect you. And protecting is, you know, code for changing privacy settings, basically. Yeah. And this is something that people just accept because you are in a way forced to. I mean, with peer pressure, with everyone being on specific platforms, with not having this capacity to distribute resources.
Okay, so this is one aspect of the new normal. We have Miguel and Ole with us. Shima was not able, unfortunately, to be with us. So what are some other aspects of the new normal in terms of society, in terms of solidarity, in terms of like the new geographies that are being formed by the crisis? As far as I know, Miguel is from Madrid and Frankfurt. He also used to live here. Daria is from here, but she's moving to the United States in a couple of days. So we have people from all different kinds of places. So my question is, how is this crisis changing the geography of solidarity today, Miguel?
Miguel,
are you here? Ole, you can jump in. I mean, it's a general question.
Okay. So I was thinking
about...
Thank you
for being here with us tonight.
Yes, I'm happy to be here. Am I on a huge screen now? Like Big Brother?
Like the Wizard of Oz.
Okay, I see. So
yeah.
I think something... I mean, I think Miguel is speaking now. He's moving his... I think... yeah, something happens there. Miguel?
You can hear me?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, you can go on, Ole, and then Miguel can jump in as soon as...
So what I was thinking about, I think we still have to use scenario thinking because there is so much that we don't know. For example, will there be a second wave of COVID? Are we in the post-COVID times now, or has it just begun?
The post-new post-COVID situation.
Yes. So, but something that is very interesting is that I read an analysis from Ernst & Young, and they had made interviews with hundreds of leaders, and they actually raised the question that this can bridge us into basic income closer. And I was thinking about, so say that the industrialized part of the world, actually, we have to take that step because of automation. There is not enough work. There are no supply and demand don't match. And so we have to have basic income. And this will definitely change the motivation of people. You were talking about like the rat race of neoliberal capitalism. I think what I have seen here in Sweden is that a lot of people have been, what's the word? We call it permitted in Swedish. It means that basically you're on the dole. So the state has a lot of industries, they have cut down their workforces and the state has paid for it. So a lot of white collar people, highly educated white people, they have been staying at home, tending their garden, spending time with their families and so on. And I think you cannot like unsee or unexperience those days. When you enter like the corridors of the industries again, you will have a very fresh comparison that I did what I love to do, and now I'm not sure if I'm doing what I love to do. So I think this can be like very, very big. And it's basically the basic motivation of the industrial society that we are, we will start to question. It seems very cliche to say that like the commuter, he thinks about why am I going to work? What is the value? But I think there is really power in this situation, because if people don't feel like going to work, things will change very rapidly.
And speaking of change, it was really interesting to follow, you know, reactions of local local public in terms of what was happening in Sweden because of the peculiarities of the Swedish model and all the information that was coming from Sweden to Belgrade about what's going on in Sweden. So I have to ask you about that. You know, how does it feel when you are actually there? You're experiencing the famous or the infamous Swedish model.
Yes, so first of all, I would like to say in general, people have they tend to idealize the Sweden, like the model country. I mean, we have a lot of problems here, but I could say that
But you know, it's usually, you know, the leftists who idealize Sweden, but here I think liberals started idealizing Sweden just because of this response to the crisis.
Yes. But the thing is that I have seen in a way that Sweden have become a bit divided, because they said, okay, we will not have any hard lockdown. You must act according to recommendations and be solidaric with your fellow Swedes. And it resulted in that some people are very careful, and some people don't really care. So there is it's very, very polarized. So I'm part of the population where I've been really, really careful, not like mixing population. My town's population, I shouldn't mix it by going and visiting people. I have stayed at home. I was in Stockholm yesterday for the first time for 6 months, which is just an hour from where I live. I normally go there very often. It was a very strange experience. It was the new normal, you know, this surreal, I don't think we're in Kansas anymore experience. And I just had this feeling, I want to go home again, because this urban environment, it pushes all the stimuli and things on me. When I'm home with my internet connection, I can pull out what I want. The stimuli, so in a way, I cannot like unexperience that. I am deeply changed by this. But
what about your writing practice? Has it changed because of that?
No, I mean, it's perfect. It's a perfect situation for a writer. So in a way, me and my wife, we have been working from home. And so my personal experience is that it's in a way solidified the lifestyle we had. And also, I have seen my children, who are white collar workers. In a way, what I think they have been starting to do is to question a bit what they're doing back at work. Because they have, when they take one step back and things are not that urgent anymore, they start to see things from a more existential point of view. And is this the right place to spend my times and so on? And I think that all those personal experiences will add up, and I think it will be different. And then there is something special with Sweden, I would say, and that is our nature, because our small towns and even the bigger towns, most of them, the nature is very close. And to actually, people have been spending a lot of time walking in the forest. I think that Sweden has, in a way, reconnected to nature in a great way.
But you know, I mean, it's always great to reconnect with nature, and yeah. I mean, I'm trying to feel it myself with these long walks. Every time I can do that, but at the same time, yeah. I feel isolated, and I feel this need for intimacy, this need for connections that can somehow be deeper than the regular connections that can we build online. And because I'm also a teacher, I feel that teaching that I do online is not sufficient, and I need this kind of human emotions that can be produced only by, you know, physical, actually being in the same room with your students and with people that you're talking to. And all this, you know, comes to this question of solidarity, of empathy, basically.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
What is the what do you think is going to be this new normal of solidarity, of empathy, of human connection, of all these things that we somehow are more open to because of these existential things that you were talking about, but at the same time, we are still, you know, isolated.
Yeah. I think in a way that what I see is people have like started exploring their own the places where they live, and they have started like tighten their connections with the people that they are allowed to. So I think you're in some kind of a network with the people who are close to you.
Yeah, yeah.
And so you deepen those connections, and you look closer to the place where you live. So it's in a way, I need to think. Miguel, jump in. Because
so
I
basically,
need to think about
Ole, you're an optimist in terms of these connections, developing connections.
Yes, I mean, if I see it from a selfish point of view, I would say that all our like private networks and so on, we will deepen the connections. But then, like our wider networks, perhaps they are suffering. So if you look at me, for example, I have been traveling, I have been to Belgrade, giving talks to Poland and Denmark and so on. I don't meet those people. I just meet them online. And as you say, there is a urge in me growing that I want to be in Belgrade. I want to sit in that couch with you. You know.
It's, yeah. This is really interesting. We can talk about this urge, and this is what Miguel can tell us more about. This is what I mean by this term, geography of solidarity.
Yeah,
this idea that you can actually be emotionally connected with people who sit, I don't know, in Madrid, in Frankfurt, in Bahrain, in Moscow, in South Africa, in Pacific. This kind of connectedness that somehow the 21st century is calling for, because all the biggest problems of the 21st century are global problems. The technopolitics, the biopolitics, financial things, migrations, all these, you know, huge things. At the same time, we're living this reconnection with this micro communities, this micro traveling. You want to add something, Ole?
Yes, I think that culturally we are a bit better prepared of being isolated, because I know we are lone wolves. We have like every Swede, every Finn has a lone wolf in their heart. I mean, when we go to a lake, we look for a place where there are no other people. That's the Swedish style. So I think we can cope with isolation a little better.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah.
Miguel, do you hear us?
You can hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, it's quite an interesting topic. You can hear me or not?
Yes, we do hear you.
Yeah, I can hear you perfectly, but I don't know if you can see me or...
Yes, we see you.
Oh, okay. Well, let's say dobro veče svima. That's the first thing that I should say. Yeah, you raise a very interesting question, but I do have a more critical or negative approach, let's say.
Great, we are open ago, to different approaches.
I know that. I saw a meme that personally concerned me a lot and which is quite descriptive with our new normality. In this meme, you can see the same sketch 9 times. A man is sitting in front of the computer doing different activities. So the same person. So it's like we are ordering food and we are eating food in front of the computer. We are socializing in front of the computer. We are sharing feelings in front of the computer. We work with the computer, we buy and sell things in front of the computer, we spend almost the whole day in front of the computer. No. Even if I have really great memories of Belgrade and I would like to be there, I'm not there, you know. And that's create a kind of frustration because you keep in touch, but you are not going deep in those relationships, no? In that sense,
do you think it's impossible to go to you know develop deeper relationships via this technological platforms? I'm also skeptical.
I don't think so. I think the sense of trust, for example, the body language, they are like really really relevant in order to understand the other. The atmosphere is crucial as well for developing all of these relations. So I think that even right now that we are really, really connected at the global level, somehow we are more alone, you know, and many studies, they prove that we are getting more anxious because we don't have the opportunity to be in touch with other people. I spent 5 months that I didn't give the hand to anybody. It was like yesterday. I didn't even touch my dad. He lives in Madrid. And when I arrived there, I couldn't touch him because I arrived in the airport. So all of these things, I think that they are affecting us on a psychological level. Even if we cannot rationalize it, it's affecting us. So I think it's very important to go to a new normality that is really, really social, more than connected in digital terms.
More social than connected. Yeah, that's interesting.
What do you say, Ola?
Yeah.
Social.
No, I was thinking about the last sentence of what Miguel said. More social than connected. So I like that.
So, Daria, you're about to move to the U.S., and so we're having a lot of, you know, geographical places in this conversation. How do you feel in terms of all this that we were talking about? This discrepancy between the lack of intimacy and at the same time, you know, these new things that opened up for each one of us because of the crisis.
I think that in the sphere of the social and the body, there is an interesting thing that happened politically around the world, and it is that when people got a bit of time outside of having 3 jobs trying to raise money for families or just to survive, because all around the world it is very extreme in the way that people live today in order to survive, people started protesting. And this has been happening all around the world. It has been mostly political, also economic, but we can see these waves
isolation,
happening everywhere.
Isolation, atomization on one hand. On the other hand, we have these huge crowds, people protesting all around the world.
And I think it is actually also an effective desire, because it is a desire to bring bodies together for a shared political view.
Is it a glitch or something more substantial?
It's substantial in terms of possibilities. And possibilities for change are happening because people are realizing more and more that there are systems that you can live not depending on. There are some formalities that we can live without. For example, I was just thinking about it. I mean, it's interesting. It's also super weird when you're speaking at an event and you're somewhere far away and you're sitting in your home and your home is the same home that you eat in and you're just on a conference now. The way that conferences in the last few months became less formal, that they demand less events, that they demand less things, that we can do things with less of this effort. Outputs
cheaper.
From this, even cheaper, but I'm even thinking of just lowering formality. And I think this effect will actually stay afterwards. The effect of learning the things that you can live without.
It has something to do with what all of us talking about the work culture, like people working from home and realizing that maybe one day, when all this is finished in, I don't know, 5 years, who knows, 6 months, we will not be wanting to go back to work.
And also we see this with people increasingly buying land, buying houses, growing their own food, trying to be more independent and managing to do that because it depends where you live, depends what...
How
what
to be more independent in the times of this increase of systemic complexity, in this time when we are surrounded by all these systems. Technological systems, social networks, credit cards, visas, all these, I don't know, medical systems. Like we are surrounded by these systems, embedded. Maybe this is something that was new for me. All these systems became a little bit more visible for me than they used to be. So what does independence mean in terms of this?
Going
for
extreme.
You?
Going extreme, growing your own food. A lot of people are doing this. It's not as extreme as it seemed before. This is the beauty of it. That you can actually have another house somewhere or just land somewhere or just get a piece of land that you rent from someone and grow your own food. For
Ole has a comment.
Yeah, I think it's very interesting to see how I have seen the work market change now in 6 months that... I have like made a lot of new contacts and started new corporations on a global scale. And I actually read an article today that they see this as a big trend that the work market is much more globalized. It doesn't matter where people live. So I think this being a farmer and an intellectual at the same time, I think that's a great match.
The best combination.
One of my best friends, who is a PR consultant, he lives on the southern tip of one of our biggest islands here outside Sweden, and he has like sheep and cows. And then he does some writing for big organizations. I think he's like a trendsetter.
What about Spain or Germany or you're in Spain right now, Miguel, right?
Yeah, I think that in Spain, the impact of the pandemic was really huge. So there are like several concepts that are like now rooted in the society. One of them is fear about the future. Another thing I think is quite relevant because it seems that the new normality is like going very fast, and we were already going very fast before the pandemic. You know, it's like the many things are changing very fast, and we have to adjust to all of them. No, I for example, I will give you an example. For me, it was terrific. No, the 2008 global crisis in Spain. Was largely addressed with the efforts of families and retirees. So that is the generation that was born after the Spanish Civil War and somehow brought democracy and stability to Spain. However, they are the main victims during the pandemic. It is estimated that 20,000 elderly people have died in residence from COVID-19. Most of them completely alone and without their family members. You know. So I think that now when we analyze this new normality, we really want to move forward. We really want to fix everything and come back to the previous normality as soon as possible. But I think that it could be different in each country. You know, I can see, for example, how easily Germany adjusts to the pandemic, while in Spain the situation was completely different.
What do you see?
And I can sense it. For example, people were extremely afraid, like in the sense that the atmosphere was like not frightening, but in a very bad mood, because the crisis of 2008 was really huge. With really huge, and it seems that my generation have to fight twice. No, had to fight in 2008, and we have to do it again. So the perspective, for example, in Spain are quite negative, for example, and in that sense, I think that we need the moment of reflection. No, in the sense to know where are we going. No, this let's say like the song. No, Despacito. No, to know exactly where are we moving.
So what do you think is going to be the next normal? In terms of what you were saying, what do you think is going to be the next normal?
Well, I think that
because we are not going to return to the old, we don't want to, or it's not possible. So what's going to be the next normal?
I think that the crisis mainly in intensified patterns. If something what happened before now is going to happen, but in a more intense way. No, for example, before the pandemic, we were really afraid of the future, but at the same time, we have nostalgia for the future. No, so those societies that are more idealistic, those societies that they have more social trust, they will adjust themselves better to the pandemic. But those societies who were like dealing with the pandemic in a populist way, for example, or in a inequality way, they will suffer much more. You know? And I think that it's very important in terms of the whole Europe that somehow we keep kind of equality, you know, in sense of well-being, safety, health, economic livelihood, and are really, really important elements when we talk about Europe. So it's very important in the current situation, for example, that in countries like, let's say, Germany, Holland, and so on, those countries to try to help economically, those countries like Spain, or Italy, who suffer the impact of the crisis.
So it's fight for equality and fight for solidarity. That we are basically what we need to do.
Yeah, I think that there are elements that are let's say how can I explain you. Quite relevant, no? Because the good thing of the pandemic was that it makes our societies more transparent. It shows all the problems that each state has. For example, in Spain, COVID-19 has come to show the wounds of the system. No, we saw in TV, exploited immigrants, cuts in public health. The disorientated educational system, we don't know right now how they will open the schools, in which way, how they will control the pandemic in the schools, how easily we sacrifice the future of our youth. When you analyze what were happening in Spain during the last 6 months, you can see that the less relevant part of the society were the children. And disco, clubs, bars, for example, they were more irrelevant than the future of the education of the country. So it's really really important that this pandemic helped us to see in each country in which way we are weak in terms of institution, society, and so on.
There's also hospitals. You're talking about schools, but there's also hospitals. And I read in the news that Spain has nationalized hospitals, private hospitals. That's something that was completely unthinkable a couple of years ago, a couple of months ago, basically.
Yeah,
it's something that you know.
We were like before crisis.
I'm talking about the nationalization of private hospitals.
I think it's right now it's been the opposite. It's the privatization of the health system. It happened even before. We were really proud of the health system in Spain, and now with the crisis, we realize how many health staff they died during the crisis because they didn't have enough equipment. Mm-hmm. And that shows that in that sense we were not so strong as we thought. So right now it's a claim by the society to invest more money in hospital instead of decentralizing privatizations and so on. So I think that I'm really interested as a citizen what will happen in the next election if we really get some lessons of this process that it has a huge impact in Spain, as you know, different in the case of Sweden, for example. So there's this risk in Europe, no, of countries with different speeds, because what is happening right now can influence in a very bad way in the following generation. So, well, we will see, you know, how and where the new normality goes.
Thank you, Miguel. Okay, just two short, yeah. Question for Ole. What is the next normal? Because we have only 2 minutes.
The next
1 minute
normal
for you, 1 minute for Daria. Yeah. We're finishing.
Yeah. Yes. Okay. I had this reflection about the plague in the mid 14th century that made normal people question the power of church. I think we may be in the same situation here, that people have lost part of the trust in the structures that keep up society. But okay, the next normal, yeah, I think that will be that we have seen something different. We have opened a door and seen some well, it's like Doctor Who. We have been into a parallel dimension and see another scenario, and when we step back, we cannot unsee that. And I think that the educated white collar workforce, I'm not sure if they are as prepared as running the rat race in the faceless global capitalism. I think people will see that they want to spend their time on things that create meaning for them.
Thank you. Thank you, Ole. Daria, just one sentence. Next normal.
Independence and co-creation with technology.
Thank you. Okay, thank you, Miguel. Thank you, Ole. Thank you, Daria. Thank you all very much for being here tonight. And see you soon. Bye-bye.